Hello everyone! Good evening! Hello! I can hear you guys! Thank you very much for tuning to Japanese Whiskey Lockdown, the very first live streaming! Yay! Welcome to the first ever Decanter Live and the celebration of our 5th anniversary! Yay! Decanter is 5 years old now. Yeah, same old as my inner child. I'm so happy about it. And happy birthday, Decanter! I hope you sing it together. 3, 2, 1. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Decanter, happy birthday to you. Thank you, thank you, thank you very much for your participation. Anyway, again, welcome to Japanese Whiskey Lockdown, a special live streaming, and I'm your host, Kilara Sen, aka Pink Unicorn, from Tokyo. Well, I know it's 8:30 p.m. in New York, 7:30 p.m. whatever, around the evening. But here in Japan, now it's 8 a.m. Yes, 8 a.m. Saturday. So I work on Saturday and also start drinking whiskey already. Now you can see how much hardworking I am. Thank you for clapping hands. Thank you, thank you, thank you. So anyway, I'm so happy to see you in live tonight. And yeah, let's have fun together. So tonight, we have lots of fun in store for you tonight from a live Q&A with some Japanese whiskey masters to lip sync battle. And we'll be asking you to guess what's in our panis glasses. So we'll also be revealing some very, very special news and announcing the winner of our Toast Decanter competition. And if you haven't already got your entry in, don't miss your chance to show us some birthday love, birthday wishes, post a video or a photo of yourself toasting a decanter with a hashtag Toast Decanter, hashtag Toast Decanter with your favorite Japanese whiskey on our social medias like Instagram, Facebook, or Twitter. Yeah, thank you very much for your cooperation. And the participation. And we welcome you to join us for the lip sync battle. If you haven't already told us you'd like to participate, just leave the comment in the chat. And we are checking that all time. So you can jump in our lip sync battle later. And we have been on an exciting journey the past 5 years, sourcing amazing bottles of Japanese whiskey and delivering them at all across the globe to our wonderful Decanter family. That's you. So thank you very, very much. And we are so happy these 5 years. So I have only been on this journey for a short while, but already have tried some great Japanese whiskeys and met lots of Japanese whiskey experts through Decanter TV's Japanese Whiskey Lockdown. We hope you have been enjoying these shows during lockdown, and please continue to join us Fridays at 8:30 p.m. EDT, EST, for more fun and guest interviews and Japanese whiskey. So, are you ready for the fun night or for morning? I believe you are. I believe you are. Oh, okay. Thank you. You know, comedians are very, very lonely persons. So I always need your reaction. Yeah, so just be free to comment your, just be free to post your comments in the chat, and we always sing it. And okay. Now I can see you guys are all ready. All right, so the first fun thing tonight, first very, very fun time for tonight is hashtag Toast Decanter Photo Contest. Yay! So we have been looking out for the very best entries to our Toast Decanter competition. And I have to say they have been amazing. They are all amazing. Yes, so let's take a look at the top photo entries and you could be in there. All right, okay, the first guy is Justin from Washington. Wait, which is Justin? Which is Justin's? Anyway, wow. Thank you very much. And a really good beer. And Jean Paul from California. Wow, it seems like he dropped his reed in the desert and he was like, oh my God, just hurry, drink it. All right, next one. Alexander from Australia. Oh my God, cat posted pictures. Oh my God, she has so smart brain. Wow, thank you, Alexander. And Frank from California. Wow, he posted the picture of his favorite hot dog with his favorite combination with hot dog, that is yellow mustard and Hibiki whiskey. All right, next, Ian from Glasgow. Wow. Isn't he on the rooftop or something? So he's being like, oh my God, don't push me, don't kill me. Just be nice to everyone. Thank you. And Michael from New York. Wow, I love it. This glass looks like a little bit karaoke mic. Yeah, so he looks like a specialist of whiskey karaoke. Anyway, amazing. And next, Kelsey from Cape Town. All right, the whiskey is old, but she is young forever. Okay, next. Kevin from California. He look like, okay, who wanna date with me tonight? You guys are all of my girlfriend. I can choose anyone. It looks really sexy. I love it. All right, next. Raj from New Delhi. It looks like he is very deep thinker. Like, I think I found out something wrong with my brain. My left side of brain doesn't have anything right. And my right side of brain has nothing left. Whatever. Let's move on. Stefan from Germany. All right. He's saying like, I might look potato, but I will be French fries sometime. You need me. I love it. Oh, that's beautiful. Beth from Missouri. Wow. Tea time ceremony with whiskey. I love it. And all right, Beth from Missouri, the same. Oh, he is her husband. Okay, well, he looks like he's going to experiment, like, to make sure if the cat has 9 lives, truly. All right, next. Ryan from Hawaii. Alcoholic Anonymous. Let's go. Efrain from California. I love your mustache. I love it. Let's move on. Randy from Pomona. Well, actually, she has birthday wishes behind him. And yeah, that was the best birthday wishes from a man in black. And, Scott from Virginia. He looks very responsible guy. He would say like, it's gonna be whiskey drinker's responsibility not to spit it. And James from New York. Maybe he is very, very kind of person and he gonna pour this whiskey into his plants. Okay, Kevin from California. Wow, cool t-shirt, by the way. Somebody's drowning, yeah? And Alexander from Kiev, Ukraine. Wow, hi, thank you. Wow, that's so cool. Wow, he also has plants behind him. Maybe he'll be pouring the whiskey into the plants. Okay, next. Akio-san. Okay, that's all. Wow, thank you very, very much for beautiful pictures and I love all of them. All right, so from these pictures, we gotta choose the winner. Now you have seen our favorite entries and it is your opportunity to tell us your favorite. So go to the Decanter Facebook page at facebook.com/DecanterWhiskey and enter your vote for your favorite photo. At the end of Decanter Live, we'll announce the winner of the competition and the runner-up who will be the lucky winners of some Japanese whiskey. There is a Hibiki 17-year-old and Yamazaki, 12 years old, up for grabs. So the stakes are really, really high. So go and cast your votes, please. So, but don't take too long. We have lots of exciting things lined up for you. podcast. So if you want to cast vote, yeah, just go facebook.com, The Count of Whiskey, and vote now. Just quickly. The first impression. All right. So let's move on to the next thing we have for tonight. The next one is also very, very exciting, and you should love it. So now is the opportunity to get the insider information on all things Japanese whiskey. So we have an amazing panel of Japanese whiskey industry experts who cover all sides of the industry, from inside the big brands to online retail, bars and restaurants, to covering the latest Japanese whiskey news. So let me introduce our very, very special guests for tonight, some of whom you'll be familiar with. So first, please welcome our very own head of content here at Decanter, spirits writer and the Japanese whiskey hunter, Liam Heater. Hey, Liam!
How are you? Thanks, Clara. Nice to be here.
Hi, thank you. How are you?
I'm good, thanks. How are you?
I'm so fine. I'm already drunk. As you know. All right, so let me introduce the next panel. Next up is a familiar face from Decanter TV, the UK brand ambassador of the House of Suntory and the taster of many Karizawa whiskies, James Barker!
Hello! Hello! How are you all doing?
Good. Wow,
Kanpai.
Oh, great. Wow, you cut your hair.
I did. I was realizing that I looked a bit more like a lion and it doesn't suit my tiny personality and physicality. So back to normal.
Thank you. Thank you for joining. All right. So we also have Brad Jeff, who is a food, spirits and a travel writer. You may recognize him, his name from The Hollywood Reporter, the National Geographic, Condé Nast Traveler, Forbes, Travel Leisure and the Boston Globe, and many more. So please welcome Brad Jeff.
It's okay. Hello, thank you so much for having me. Happy weekend.
You outside now?
Oh yeah.
Where are you?
I'm in Hawaii, very close to you. I could swim over to you right now if you'd like. Just a little bit further back that way.
Wow, but it's really nice weather. Actually, in Japan, now it's very raining heavy. I'm so envious. Cheers. And the next panel should be Makio-san, or...
Hi.
Okay, sorry, I confused the order, but yeah, okay, Makio-san. All right, so... let me introduce Makio-san. Maybe everybody knows her, but just in case, let me introduce her and very, very special guest for tonight and the mother of Decanter herself, our founder and director, Makio Masa!
Hi, namaste. Hello, everybody. Hi. Thank you.
Tanjoubi omedetou gozaimasu. Okay, and let me introduce the other panels. And he is ambassador for the whiskey. Okay. Sorry, I got kind of confused. It's live. Anything can happen. Yeah, just be nice to me, please, please. I'm working so hard in the second language, and with getting drunk, even, you know. Okay. All right, so let me introduce the next guy. He is ambassador for the Whiskey Exchange and knows a thing or two about Japanese whiskey and Asian spirits. So please welcome Billy Abbott.
Hello, everybody. Good evening.
Hello. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. And if you're in San Francisco and you love Japanese food and whiskey, you have to know this guy. Khalid the Journey, owner of Nihon Whiskey Lounge in San Francisco. Hi, Khalid.
Hello, greetings all.
Hi.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you very much for joining us. And I was supposed to introduce Makio-san at this this point. So again, please welcome Makio-san.
Thank you. Arigato gozaimasu. Hello.
Bye. Thank you. Thank you. So, thank you very much for joining us tonight. And many of you have already submitted your question for our esteemed panel of guests. But if you haven't yet submitted a question, it is not too late. Don't worry. So put your questions in the Zoom chat and our team will select the best ones to ask our panelists. So, let me choose the question. So many questions we got. I think we have a lot of questions. Now I'm looking for questions. Where is it? Okay, so I got a question to Liam.
Hello.
Hi. I love your hair. You want to dye it pink?
My hair. Yeah, I could do that.
Well, like it's just a question from me, though.
Well, good, right?
Yeah. And actually, I have a question for you. So, yep. Liam, you have many, many different expressions on the kanta. How do you go about sourcing these?
Right, okay, that's a good question. So, because we've got so many different expressions, we go about sourcing them in a number of different ways. So first and foremost, we build strong relationships with distilleries around Japan. Right now, I mean, we're working closely with the likes of Nagahama, Akashi, Asaka. I mean, we're working a lot of the newer distilleries, and we're always looking to build those relationships to get our hands on the whiskies first, be the first to have them online. When it comes to the more rare bottles, which we obviously stock a lot of, we're obviously always actively seeking out collectors who are looking to sell their collections, because that's, I mean, some of these bottles were made 30 years ago, so finding them on the shop shelves is very, very difficult. So we'll actively seek out collectors who are looking to sell their collections, or if we have a client that comes to us looking for a specific bottle, occasionally if we can't find it within our own circles, we will occasionally go to the secondary market and try and look for that there for them. Because like I say, I mean, a Karazawa from, you know, the 1960s or 1970s or whatever is no longer very easy to find. So yeah, we've got a number of different ways we do it, but yeah, each and every one of them allows us to have a wide range of expressions. And that's the goal, you know, is to bring Japanese whiskey to the masses and make it accessible for everyone.
Thank you. Wow, that's great. No. All right. Uh-oh, let's move on to the next question. I got another question to James.
Okay.
One on everyone's lips. Okay. Sanctuary has been one of the hardest hit by the whiskey shortage. So can you tell us a bit more about this continuations and when we are likely to see those whiskies being produced again?
Of course, yeah, absolutely. So it's one of those really hard things that the whole whiskey industry is facing. And we often say it's the Japanese whiskey industry facing shortages. And the reality is it's the whole world, because for a good 20 years or so, 80s and 90s, the whole world stopped drinking whiskey in the way they used to, and they've suddenly started again. So we see this global boom, and at the same time, Japanese whiskey was kind of discovered, as it were, by all these global whiskey experts that give out all the awards. And in terms of the Suntory line specifically, because obviously I'm here talking about Suntory today, so there's a couple of myths actually about some of our whiskies. So there's the Hakushu 12-year-old and the Hibiki 17-year-old that people often talk about as having been completely discontinued or stopped in any way. And it's just a myth. It's not true. We are still producing Hibiki 17 and Hakushu 12-year-old. We're bringing it into as many countries as we can. We're raising production constantly. So it's actually relatively easy to get hold of those two products that everyone thought were kind of impossible to find. You've just got to find a retailer that has allocation. Because one thing that Shinjiro Tori, one of the founding fathers, there's kind of Taketsuru and Tori were the two big godfathers of Japanese whiskey. And he wanted it to be available for as many people as possible. The whole point of Suntory was to get spirits to as many people as possible. So we really carefully control what shops get how many bottles to make sure that as many places across the world can get good access to it. So first up, don't worry, the vast majority of the range is still there and we're not going to get rid of it. The one product that was discontinued was, of course, that beloved and my much-loved Hibiki 12-year-old. And it's so sad not to see it anymore. I've seen a lot of people on Decanter talk about that product. And the reality is, of course, we had to let something go. And that was just a product that didn't quite fit into the family in exactly the same way. It was in those wonderful Umeshu plum liqueur casks, which we weren't making as much of anyway. And the rest of our range, you can see them all up there. They use the same six casks. And we wanted to celebrate those kind of fantastic signature Suntory flavors and focus on those rather than having everything at once, basically. But yeah, they were all still going. We're going to keep producing more.
Wow. That's one of the greatest news we have tonight. Yay! Yeah, we believe you, James. Yeah. Wow, that's great. That's great. Thank you, James. And another question. Okay, another question we got is for Brad. As an AV traveler, you must have visited some Can I spell it out?
Yeah, please.
Sorry for my language ability. Okay. IDYLLIC. Okay, lovely places.
Idyllic. Yeah.
Idyllic places. Uh-huh. What has been the most memorable place when you enjoy the whiskey?
Well, that's a very, very difficult question, of course. But thankfully, some of the places that produce the most beautiful spirit are also some of the places that are the most beautiful. So part of my job going around and tasting these incredible whiskeys, it also brings me to some incredible places. And I would say actually that Hakushu, that distillery up in the Japanese Alps, is absolutely sensational. I feel similarly attached to Chichibu up there in the mountains of Japan. And then of course I love the highlands of Scotland, and Isla is one of my favorite places on the planet for sure. So if I was forced to pick one place, I would have to say Isla. But man, there, I don't think that you could go wrong in terms of any place that produces fantastic liquid is also just happens to be, as you just said before, an idyllic locale. So keep traveling, keep exploring, and keep drinking good whiskey, and they'll go hand in hand, particularly when we can safely do that again. But just as a side note, that's what's been so such a good consolation prize during this time when we can't really travel the way that we used to, or, you know, what we'd like to do, is that these drinks are so transportive and they take us to these places in our mind. It's the really the next best thing to getting in a plane and actually going to the places. It's just taking a sip from that distillery in the highlands of Scotland or in the, you know, in the Japanese Alps, and all of a sudden you're just there.
Great. Thank you. Well, can I show off my privilege as a Japanese? I am planning to visit Chichibu next weekend. That's it. Don't get jealous. You can sometimes.
We are all very jealous.
Actually, Chichibu is a very, very beautiful place. So yeah, I gotta enjoy the nature. But yeah, thank you, Brad. And we really wanna travel around soon. Thank you. And the next question to Billy. Is Bill here?
I am here.
All right. A question from Rudra. As you are brand educator and ambassador, what are the skills needed to teach people about whiskey across the globe?
That's a difficult question. I have a weird job because I'm a ambassador for a shop. So for most brand ambassadors, they have to get out there, they have to sell their whiskey, whereas I have to just tell people all about the great things that a shop does, which means I can talk about pretty much any whiskey under the sun, which makes my life a little bit easier and a little more fun. But the sort of skill, you know, I'm outside of just telling people about what we do, my sort of two bits of my role are, I'm a trainer. I teach people. That's what I've been doing for years. And I now teach people about whiskey. I occasionally sort of cheat and sort of make it so that being a brand ambassador is external training. I do internal training as well. No, the skill, you just need to, it's all about having a passion for your topic and wanting to tell people about it. If you know what you're talking about and you want to teach people, want to pass on that knowledge, that's the core thing. You know, I'm no matter what I've trained in people in over the years, it's always been stuff I've loved, and I like passing on that knowledge to other people.
Thank you. And at school, there are some bad students. How about whiskey? Is there any point that you want to change for young people, like having any specific image against whiskey or something?
Well, we're quite fortunate in that whiskey's image has changed a lot over the years, and you know, it's gone from being something which was, when I was a kid, it was either very, very highbrow or very lowbrow, and there wasn't very much in the middle. Now this is whole range, whole spectrum, and people appreciate it as a drink a lot more from a lot earlier. And you don't get quite so much of the problematic drinking that you may have. But no, whiskey's it's a great leveler. There is a whiskey for everybody. There is a whiskey at every price point. Anybody who wants to learn about interesting spirits can find a whiskey now they would like to try. If you're in the UK, finding a Japanese whiskey at every single price point is more difficult. But in Japan, you're fine. But no, there are whiskeys out there so that anybody can get involved. And that's one of the great things about whiskey at the moment.
All right. I got it. Thank you so much. Thank you. Arigatou gozaimasu. And the next question is to Khalid. This might divide opinions, but Reynaldo wants to know, what is the best way to drink Japanese whiskey, with ice or just a few drops of water?
Oh, very interesting. I think whiskey, my default answer is drink whiskey however you think you enjoy that that glass of whiskey. For me personally, I enjoy drinking whiskey actually neat. However, if the whiskey, if I'm having it with food, I probably put a couple of cubes of ice to chill it. I enjoy that with food, but neat to be the default approach for me, especially as the whiskey gets older. It's of an older vintage, finer whiskey. I believe the distillers, the blenders have done their homework and they created the whiskey in the shape they want us to drink it in. So neat seems to be the approach I would drink it, especially also Japanese whiskey. The Japanese whiskeys are such amazing, refined, mild whiskeys. And I wouldn't want to overly put water or ice unless you're drinking it in a highball. And these tend to be the younger whiskeys. Yeah. So I would say neat for me.
Okay. So yeah. Just try it. Okay. And another question to Makio-san. Question from Coco.
Hi.
Okay. Oh, I am very interested in this too. How did you come up with the Shibari packaging idea?
This bottling it's a joint project with my partner, so we have been discussed going back and forth. So finally we came up with this idea, but exactly just we think it's good to present a part of the Japanese culture. So it's, I mean, it's where it is come from. I it's just we've been discussed and just want something unique. We think it's Japanese whiskey and the culture. It's very sexy, beautiful. So we think with this bottle, with this packaging, will be presented properly.
How did you learn how to tie the rope? did you study?
Oh. I didn't do myself, but yeah, each bottle it took about 2 hours to really do the work. It's it's quite a work.
Wow, that's hard work. Mm-hmm. Okay. Great to know. Thank you. Okay, so
thank you.
I got another question to James Sam. Throughout the whiskey shortage, Suntory has managed to release the Essence series and a few other unique bottlings. Can you tell us a bit about the composition of these whiskies?
Yeah, so of course, some of you may know that there was this original company motto from Junjiro Tori, which was Yate Minahara, which kind of like Nike is, it means go for it, you know, really try and do something different. And it also reminds me of, there's another thing that comes to mind is the Japanese philosophy of Kaizen, of continually trying to innovate and improve and do things a little bit differently. And one of the really cool things about the Japanese whiskey industry is it's one of the newest whiskey industries in the world, despite having all this incredible heritage. You know, it's much, much newer to the world than Scotland, Ireland, and America. And the consequence of that is they can really kind of try new things and feel free to explore new avenues for whiskey and be at the vanguard of what's coming out. So the idea with the Essence range is we've got a few secret projects that we work on. We've got a few crazy scientists working on different ideas of flavor and just basically exploring new avenues for us. So at the secret distillery in Hakushu that's hidden away where we do our experimental stuff, as well as our little blending room at Yamazaki, you can find just the craziest bits and bobs. Sometimes they're hints at the future and sometimes they're just a bit of a tease, but they're always delicious.
Well, that's good to know too. Thank you, James-san. And is there any other question? Okay, I got another, well, so many questions. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for your participation. All right, so we got another new comment, a new question to Brad-san. Okay, are there any Japanese whiskey regions that have a particularly unique influence on the whiskey produced here?
Going back to the Japanese Alps, I've always kind of felt like you kind of, and maybe this is the power of suggestion, but I definitely feel like you take in like that dank forest kind of attitude there's this just essence, to use that word again, that is imparted on the spirits that come from up there. Water is obviously very much a big part of how we taste whiskey and how it's proofed down before and after it comes out of the barrel. And I feel like the pure mountain water that you have in a lot of these places definitely affects the sort of terroir, if you believe in such a thing as it applies to distilled spirits. So certainly I would say those high altitude places affect the quality of the whiskey. When you look at Karazawa, they were, at the time that they were in existence, they were the highest elevation distillery in all of Japan. And now you look at how much people clamor for their liquid. So I think that there might be some sort of direct correlation there between the higher the elevation and the higher regard that people kind of hold these liquids in.
Yeah, maybe it's maybe similar to rice.
Yeah, I don't know as much about rice, but I'd love to know more.
But actually we tell very similar thing against rice, like even in Japan there are some regions which are very familiar or popular for rice making, and they always have very, very good water at the places. So yeah, maybe mm-hmm. yeah, it should be very similar to, yeah, it's nature, you know. Yeah, whiskey is natural.
It's drink. A living, it's like a living product, you know.
Living product. That's good. Okay, thank you. Arigatou gozaimasu. And okay, so another question to Makio-san. Question from Alexander. Can you remember what the first whiskies you sold on Decanter? あれ、マキーヨさん、あれ、マキーヨさん、あ、いたいた。
So, yeah, it was a Singapore client, a client from Singapore.
Oh.
The first bottle.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay, okay. And what was the first whiskey you drink? You drank?
Good question. Let me think about that. The first whiskey, actually, it was a Scottish whiskey.
Okay, Scottish whiskey. Okay, and what was the first Japanese whiskey you drank in your life?
Hibiki 17, yeah.
Wow, that's...
First whiskey I drank.
It's a good first one, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, it is.
Now everyone is jealous now. Wow, that's why your taste or your, you know, the tongue is very good for tasting whiskey. You can judge which is
good. Thank you.
Education. Okay, thank you. And all right, so I think we still have more questions. And okay, question to Billy.
Hello. Billy-san.
So, are there any up and coming Japanese whiskey distilleries which you have your eye on?
There are, yes. I was primed for this one, so I brought props. So, I was over in Japan earlier this year and I visited Kanasuke Distillery, and it is one of the most beautiful places I've been to, just sitting in their tasting room. We walked around Shochu Distillery, which was incredible. Got a bus up the road, walked around this beautiful new whiskey distillery, only to walk into a tasting room and find this huge long room with a huge window looking out over the sea, with some absolutely beautiful, not whiskey yet. They're only about a year or so old, so not yet. But they also make some really nice shochu, some really good aged shochu. And yeah, it was a fantastic trip. I was over for a week learning about shochu, and it's my one attempt, my one chance to jump in and learn about whiskey. So I bought a hat.
Ah, it suits you.
And I bought some gin. So so Kanasuke definitely. But there's loads of distilleries popping up in Japan at the moment, which are very, very difficult to find anything about them, any of their spirit or any information outside of Japan. But the little bits I've heard just show there's so much coming up at the moment. In the next couple of years, there's going to be loads of things for us to see and learn about. Can't wait.
Kanosuke Distilleries.
Yeah.
I don't know where it is, honestly.
It's in the south. Unfortunately, I was being driven around as part of a tour, so I didn't really know where I was quite a lot of the time. But it's down near Kagoshima. Around that sort of area. It's not between Kagoshima and Miyazaki. I'm not entirely certain where, because we did lots of driving around and there's lots of us sitting in a bus looking out the window going, we can't move the road. So, but yes, no. Keep an eye on these guys. There's some really good stuff coming their way. So.
Oh, with the hat, you look like a very famous movie director. I don't know who it is, but...
There's a lot of them. I wear a lot of hats for some reason. So,
okay. Let's move on. All right. So we have another question to Khalid. Okay. Is there any Japanese whiskey and food pairing that you'd recommend?
Ah, okay. Good question, actually. For Japanese whiskey, when I'm in Japan and I eat, I always have a Kakuban highball. But that's, you can't find that anywhere really outside Japan. Or I don't know. I know we don't have it in the U.S. But I say for, by default, I would drink, if I'm going to have whiskey with food, I think Hibiki is a nice whiskey. Very easy, mild, smooth whiskey to enjoy with food. I always describe it as, if you don't know if it's whiskey, you think it's a glass of wine. That's how smooth it is. Now, obviously, if you're enjoying it with food, I would say drink the Hibiki Harmony, a younger vintage, because I enjoy the older vintages on their own. But yeah, I would say Hibiki Harmony is a great one in the U.S. And if you're ever in Japan, don't miss on Kaku Highball with food. Mm. That could never be a mistake.
Yeah. Kaku Highball is my daily whiskey, actually.
Mm-hmm. I mean, they're dangerously good, actually, I think.
And my dad also, daily whiskey was Kaku Highball too. Well, he sometimes drink it straight, though. But
I mean, sometimes when I'm in on those few trips I went to Japan with the Kaku Highball, I think for 2 weeks I'm there, I never drank a glass of water ever. It was always Kaku Highball. Right.
Wow. I'm so happy to know that there is Kaku Highball fan, big fan of Kaku Highball.
Now in the US we have Toki Highball. So
Toki Highball.
In the US we have Toki Highball. But for some reason, I have an affinity with the Kaku. But again, if you're enjoying, if you just want to, I mean, obviously, highball, not everybody can, if there is no, the flexibility of soda, water, ice is not there, I would say by default, go to our Hibiki. It's an amazing whiskey to enjoy with food.
Yeah, I agree. Arigato, Karen. Thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, so the next question. Oh, okay, it's going to be final question to me. I'm not a Okay, to me, what? Oh, okatta. I'm relieved now. I was wondering if the question was about my personal thing. What is Kirara's favorite drink for after dinner on a usual night? As I just said, maybe daily whiskey is Kaku Highball, which is very common here in Tokyo. But recently, especially Kaku Highball is, I make it by myself, but maybe Kaku Highball tastes much better if I drink it outside, like at the restaurant. So here, during staying home, I drank Ichiro's malt and Komagatake not only after dinner, after getting up, during working all day, but that was my favorite one. And especially Komagatake, I just found a new way to drink it, which is very my taste. That was mixing with umeshu. Very smoky flavor and umeshu plum wine, sweet taste went in very good harmony. And well, so far that is my favorite one. Just try it. Thank you very much for getting interested in me. All right, so this is all they are all questions we had for tonight. And thank you very much for your questions participating. And of course, thank you very much for joining all the panels. Arigatou gozaimasu.
Arigatou gozaimasu.
Arigatou gozaimasu. And here, Makio-san has some words to everyone, right?
Thank you so much for everyone who been supporting us and been stay with us
including this year already 5 years. So to me, it's a very special number. Every year is special, but especially when it comes to five, I feel like I make a big, we make a big stage. So thank you for so much for everyone. Thank you. Arigatou gozaimasu.
Yeah, arigatou gozaimasu. Mikio-san, thank you very much for finding me too. And let me drinking whiskey even during working. Arigatou gozaimasu. So, okay, let's move on to the next one. We have for fun. It's going to be one of the most entertainment. Tasting time. So from here, guests taste the whiskey and say notes, and audience, you guys try to guess what bottle it is. And person who guesses it first wins a bottle. Wow, that sounds crazy. Yeah. Okay. So please prepare yourselves. And tonight we will be testing your wits. So dear audience, as I said, I challenge you to guess the, what whiskey they are drinking, each panelist's glasses. And one by one, they will describe the aromas and the flavors they are getting from the whiskey. And they may give you other hints if they need to. So type your guesses into the chat in the Zoom window and correct guesses will win a voucher to be spent on decanter.com. So maybe it reflects the all panelists' personality. You can be tricky or you can be honest, or I'm very, very looking forward to it. So panelists, you guys ready? Okay. Ready. Okay, so let's get started with James-san.
All right. Okay.
So what are you drinking?
Well, I can't tell you that. If I told you, I'd have to kill you. So I've got my first whiskey here. And we're going to start off with tasting notes and go really simple. So yeah, there you go. You can see the color, I guess, for those of you that want to do that. And I actually just had to refill this glass because in the time we've been chatting, it's so easy to drink. I necked pretty much the whole glass. But what you're getting here, mate, is really delicate, as you might expect. All of our whiskeys today are going to be Japanese, so really delicate, which is something I associate with great Japanese whiskeys. Think about the palates in Japan. It's all about sushi and sashimi. Compare that to Scotland. Very, very different. And the main aromas I'm getting, kind of quite gentle, quite soft fruits. For me, that expresses as stone fruits, so maybe things like ripe peaches or apricots, or I feel myself like in Italy or something. You get something kind of floral, but also rich at the same time, which I think mainly because I know this really well, I associate with cherry blossom, because that's that kind of like floral, almond-like, really delicate aromatic aroma. So I don't know if we've got any guesses as yet. And then you get this kind of delicate citrusy flavor to it as well. So it's not like, it's really hard to describe because it's not like if you bite into a lemon or anything like that. It's that sense of walking. You know, when you walk into a room where someone's being kind of grated citrus, it's that kind of very gentle, soft freshness to it. So we've got a few people getting fairly close. Someone did get it right, actually. Here we go. So two people got it right in a row. So it was Randy Gu, I think, might have been first, Hibiki 17.
Oh, it was right? It was correct?
Hibiki 17 was correct. Sorry.
Oh, okay. Hibiki 17. Oh, my God. Wow. But they're all close, like a Hibiki 12 or, yeah. Wow. So who is the first guy who answered the Hibiki 17?
So I think it was Randy, but I'm not sure. Maybe someone from Decanter wrote to double check. Noah said Hibiki, but didn't specify which, so I'm not sure that's close enough, much as I love your instinct, Noah.
Yeah. Okay, so staffs. Can I say it is Randy-san? Okay, so Randy Gu, Mr. Randy Gu, you are the winner for James. Omedetou gozaimasu. So now you get the voucher you can use on decanter.com. Let's drink more. Wow, sugoi. That's amazing. It's so surprising. Thank you, James-san. Yeah. Be free to keep drinking. All right, so the next is, okay, Liam?
Hello.
Hello. Can you explain how it tastes and the flavors?
Yeah, so this is quite a difficult one. If anyone gets the exact expression, I mean, I will be very surprised. So if you get the distillery, you're doing well. So can you all see me? Are we good? Show you the there we go. Oh, show you the liquid if you can see it. So this one is quite nutty on the nose. I'm getting kind of walnuts, kind of sweet almonds. There we go. Show you the colour. Sweet almonds, some gentle vanilla, but not too much. And again, like really soft peat, and I mean really soft. It's just kind of it's just there. It's not strong by any stretch at all. But yeah, it's a real kind of nutty vanilla peat is the main things I'm getting on the nose. Yes, that's good. We'll see. I mean, on the palate, I'm getting kind of candied orange peel, bit milk chocolate. The peat is completely gone on the palate. I'm noticing now on the finish it comes back. But on the palate, there's not a lot of peat. Bit of sea salt in there. It's strange one, because you've got all that peat on the nose and then it goes away and then it comes back at the end and just builds on the finish. Again, not too much, but it's definitely there. Have we got any? Let me see the chat and let me see how we're getting on. I can give you a hint. I think I might need to use a hint on this one. So this one is a distillery by the sea in Japan, and it was the first distillery to be granted a whiskey license in Japan in 1919.
Wow, that's huge hint, I think. Is there any correct answer?
That doesn't necessarily mean they were the first people to make Japanese whiskey. I don't believe in any. Another clue would be we have bottled two of their whiskies for previous anniversaries, both of which were very, very good.
Are there any correct answers?
I don't see any right now.
Oh, really? Oh, already.
Let me just check. We're getting. Oh no, we've got one very close, and it's our very own panelist. I don't think he can win though. So see if you look at James Bowker's reply, you will have a clue.
They can't more see mine. I sent it just to the panelists because I knew I couldn't.
Oh, you did. I see. Sorry.
Seems like cheating.
Yeah. So I mean, I don't think anyone's gonna. Oh wait, we've got one. We've got one.
Yeah. You got it.
Austin. Soborn has the area where the distillery is. I mean, it's the Akashi White Oak Distillery, and it's a 3-year-old stacky cask.
Akashi.
Indeed.
So the right answer is Akashi.
We have a couple that got close. I mean, Igashima, we probably give you that, right?
So the winner is.
Yeah, I think we'll give it to both because that's a hard one. So if we give it.
Austin and Woolly Worm. Wow.
Yeah, and Woolly Worm.
Okay, Austin, right? I can't see. All right, so Austin and Woolly Worm. Austin, Sobon, and Woolly Worm. They're the winners for Liam. Hey. Yes, you got vouchers. Great job. All right, so let's move on to the next panelist. So Billy-san. Billy-san, we can't hear
you. Sorry, I lost the mute button. I was trying to find it. Here we go. I'm back again. Hello.
Hi.
Unfortunately, I'm going to cheat, and I'm going to go for a Scottish whiskey because I've only got little samples of Japanese whiskies, and they're all really little weird things, like a Peter Tichibu, which nobody would get. So it'd be rude of me to do these because you wouldn't be able to guess them. So I've got a very classic Scottish whiskey with some very distinct flavours to it. It's a very new one. I picked it up yesterday. And tried it first last night, and it was fantastic, which is the reason why I want to tell everybody about it. So very sorry for ruining the whole Japan thing. I'm sorry. But anyway, so there we go. It's got some nice colour to it. There's three things about this whiskey. If you get, I reckon probably there's distillery, there's an age, and there's a special thing about it. If you get all three of them, that's great. But give it a little bit of time. I think people should be able to get two of them at least, so. On the nose, it's very, very smoky. I'll start with that. It's very, very smoky, very, very distinctive, special kind of smoke. The sort of, it's a very distinctive smokiness that's very obvious if you're looking at this sort of whiskey and you go, ah, yes, I know which distillery it is. It's quite sweet. It's got a little bit of fruit to it, but it's very, very medicinal, very, 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 very TCP. So, there's some things popping up. Well done, James, as ever. Hot off, you know, quick off the mark. The big thing is it's very, very, very medicinal. Medicinal is the TCP and the smell of the sea and that side of things. That's the really classic character of this whiskey, and this is very much that. And it's a special edition of their absolute classic everyday whiskey.
Mm.
It's a bit stronger than normal, bit of a punch to it.
I've got the same one at home, and it is so good, isn't it? My colleague gave me some the other day.
It's absolutely stunning. I've been trying to pick this up from the office for like the last 2 weeks, and finally I managed to run in, hand sanitize myself long enough to grab some whiskey and run away again. <This one. laughs> So there's a lot of Lagavulins have popped up in the chat. It's not Lagavulin, but it's also not Ardbeg. And if you know your geography of Isla, it's one over. It's one over. You're almost there.
Lagavulin, wish it was.
it's very specifically, it's the distillery that Lagavulin built another distillery within their distillery to try and pretend to be at one point in time. So,
such a cool story, man.
It's the joys of whiskey. No matter where you go around the world, there's ridiculous stories all the time. So, right, there's somebody has got very close. Somebody has got two out of the three key things about it. One person's got one out of the three things. So we have a distillery, right? We have a distillery and age, right? There is one more key fact. And I've told people that this is a little bit stronger than normal, with a bit more intensity than normal. And that is the final piece.
Mm.
See if anybody gets it. But there are two people who have got the right distillery who I can see right at the moment.
Oh, yeah?
Somebody's got a distillery, but the wrong number. It's so close. It's circling.
Close.
No, you're just firing out numbers now. You can't just name every single number that an age could be. That's cheating at that point, I think.
Oh, my God.
So I think, unfortunately, you see, the person who's got it, who has got closest so far has already won. So I don't think you can give Randy another prize. That'd be cheating, I think.
A quick fire round. So the first whiskey geek that can work out what you're going to call something if it's from that distillery, the most popular age and stronger, what would you call that logically?
Okay, it's Laphroaig. I'll give you the Laphroaig. Who is the Laphroaig now? Okay, so we got Laphroaig. Okay, throw in a number and a special thing.
Yep. Ooh, we've got
we've got another 10. 10 is right, but there is one extra bit to it. Yes, and there it is. We have the person who has put in. It is the brand new, as of a couple of weeks back, boy, 10-year-old,
car strength,
batch number 12. So so that's Rhea in the thing there, has jumped on it. It's the car strength bit that people didn't get. This is a fantastic whiskey. It pops up every year, and it's a lovely thing. And I get it every year. I thought I should.
So, Lafroy, 10-year-old was the right answer.
Lafroy, 10-year-old, car strength. And so, yeah, Rhea jumped on it and got it. So, well done there. Yeah, it's the car strength bit's the important bit on this one. Makes it really special.
Okay. So, Rhea and...
Yeah, that's it.
Rhea and...
Yeah. So it's, that's it, Siki, in the room. Yeah, you did say Lafroy 5, but you also said Lafroy 12, and you said Lafroy 15. You just start coming out with numbers, and that's cheating. But it was a good try.
Okay, so Rhea Matsura-san, you are the winner! Omedetou gozaimasu! Wow, voucher. So you haven't got voucher. Yeah, we still have chances, so don't give it up. Okay? All right, so arigatou gozaimashita, Billy-san. Okay, so the next panelist is Khalid.
Oh, hello.
Hi, so could you explain what it tastes like?
So it's the whiskey I've been drinking since we started, and it's a favorite of mine. If you look at the color, it's gold, like most whiskeys, but this one is characteristically very deep gold. You pick up peat. It has a hint of peat in it as you drink it. The peat is more on the palate than is on the nose. It has a very long finish, and to give you a... to cheat maybe a little bit, it is a whiskey that has an age statement on it. Actually, if people were paying attention, it's one of Brad's favorite places to visit, and he mentioned that. And you can argue it has a mint flavor to it.
Mint flavor?
It has a very rich, very long finish.
Sounds like it would be delightful on a highball.
But I wouldn't put it. It's a beautiful whiskey. It has a hint of peat. The peat, you hardly pick it on the nose, but it's there in the flavor. More in the end of as you drink it at the end. It has ripe pear flavor to it, I would say. One of the Japan's nicer whiskeys. So I think we can limit it when we're talking about it has peat in it. So we can, let me see what people are writing actually.
Right answer?
The distillery is there. Somebody has mentioned the distillery. And somebody mentioned it, and John, so we got Scott Richard, who said it as Hakushu 17, but it doesn't exist. John Heathrow mentioned it correctly, which is the Hakushu 18. So it's Hakushu 18, you better believe it, that is correct.
Oh, so Hakushu 18, so John-san. John is the winner.
Hakusho 18, John. Yeah. Yes, that's correct. John, you got it.
I thought you were describing Hakusho 12, which is why I was saying perfect for a highball. But certainly, I wouldn't want to put that Hakusho 18 into a highball.
What's very interesting about those two between Hakusho 12 and Hakusho 18 is that the Hakusho 18, the peat lasts long. The peat comes in the beginning of the drink, for me. The Hakusho 12, and if you when I compare them and contrast them together, the Hakusho 12, the peat lingers longer or pops later. With the 18, it pops in the immediately for me. On the nose, I don't pick it up that much. The peat is there when you pick up the flavor. With the 18, it's immediate. The 12 seems to come later for me, but I don't know. Too detailed to over explain it that way, but
I really do love that mint tasting note. Like I always get that mint with Hakusho, which I think, when I was talking about the attributes of like the Japanese Alps, that's kind of like that herbaceousness and that mintiness comes through like the dank forest. I always get the mint. You put a little shiso mint in there with it. If you're drinking a highball, that's beautiful stuff.
That it's a gold, Brad. I mean, you better believe it. Yes. And I remember, actually, I've had a Hakushu 12 highball at the distillery. And oh my God, it's like you think, and maybe the surrounding, like you explained it earlier, with the drinking of it, it becomes like a drink. You can replicate it somewhere else, but not in your psychology. It's unreplicable. Yeah. So you're absolutely right.
Okay, thank you, Khalid-san, arigato. And the winner, John-san, omedetou! You made it. All right, so, let's go back to James-san for the last whiskey.
Excellent, hello everyone. We had a few prepared, and I'm going to pick the weirdest and most interesting in kind of deference to the amazing collection that Decanter has. And because we were talking about these drams beforehand in the chat, and it's one that I love. So this one, its backstory for me was, this was one of the most special gifts I've ever been given, because I was lucky enough to work out in Japan for a bit. And at the end of it, I was gifted a few bottles by my boss. And this one was a particularly special one, because he'd taken me to the distillery and we'd really spent a great time there. So a bit different, quite unusual, certainly not one of their mainstream expressions, but maybe a distillery that's not associated with always having just a standard lineup, as it were. So straight away on the nose, it's big. Like literally as soon as you get near it, there is so much flavor, so much intensity. And immediately it jumps out kind of, for me, a beach barbecue is the kind of set of memories that pop out with the aromas. So it's things like lots of super vibrant fruits and some smokiness to it. Okay. It draws to mind for me, like there was a particular memory when I was a bit younger. I spent a couple of months in Africa in Tanzania. And at the end of it, we visited this place in Zanzibar. We had a barbecue on the beach with mangoes and pineapples and plantain. And it's all those sorts of rich tropical fruits, caramelized, char grilled, maybe even some corn on the cob, quite umami, but big, what we call estuary flavors in this one. So you're looking at probably a youngish whiskey, I might suggest maybe, given those big estuary flavors. Let's take it a bit slower then and get some more notes. So yeah, a lot of peat, a lot of smokiness, definitely.
Mm.
Very earthy peat. And yeah, on the palate, you jumped straight into two main flavors for me. So it's kind of, it's that kind of cooked mango, you know, when you just like whack a fresh mango on like a really hot grill with just loads of kind of proper wood smoke as well. So far, I don't think the distillery has been mentioned in the chat. I'm not being hyper branded as per request. So I've gone with perhaps that might be a clue for you guys that it might not be from my usual selection of whiskeys. And what we've got in there as well is it is all just big tropical fruits and lots of smoke. And I'm hoping that might give a good clue to a lot of you. You also get some really intense oaky flavors in there as well. And it's got this kind of, the oakiness expresses is very kind of patisserie-like. So you've got lots of those big vanillas and cinnamons and those sorts of things, okay? Now I'm gonna start giving away some perhaps clues, because I think that might be a helpful way of doing this. So yeah, right. So as I say, it's not from my usual set, right? You might notice that I'm something of a Suntory fanboy, but I'm lucky actually, I've worked for a lot of different companies and distilleries in Japan. And this is one that I spent a couple of days at. It's a distillery that was opened by someone that for me is very much a personal hero, because without this person, people of my generation, so I'm lucky enough to be under 30 and unlucky enough to be facing the world that we currently have at that age. But I probably wouldn't have tried a lot of the best whiskies from Japan if this person hadn't done a good job of saving them and preserving them for perhaps the younger generation. That person then took the money that they made from selling some of these older whiskies that I couldn't have maybe tasted, and opened a new distillery in 2004 and started producing in 2006. I'm just throwing out the clues now. The original, his grandfather was the distiller at Hanyu. Here we go, we've got a first distillery. Excellent, I think that can be the answer because you're not gonna guess, I don't think, the exact expression. So Chichibu, Alex, well done for jumping in there. So this was
this was
lovely gift from my boss, Ueno-san. So this was the Chichibu Tokyo World Championships single cask. So this one is, let's have a look through. So your hogshead cask from peated Oxbridge barley, 5 years of age and bottled at 61.6. So a lovely, lovely expression. And really one that I'm very, very grateful to for my boss, my old boss, I should say.
Wow, wow, thank you. Thank you so, the winner is?
It was Alex, I think.
Alex, which Alex?
I didn't have a surname, funnily enough, so I don't know.
Alex. Okay.
It was, yeah, it was just after Austin Sobon said Karazawa 17, sadly not, and Alex then said Chichibu, followed very quickly by Noah.
That was kind of tricky because I introduced you as a Karizawa whiskey drinker.
Yeah, true. I mean, I'm genuinely just, I've been lucky enough to be kind of collecting for like 8-9 years now, and I just got a good set back here at home. Very nice. It's a good for me, like having talked about one of my favorites, Hibiki, it's like the size of Japanese whiskey, super delicate, all the way through to big, punchy, powerful things as well.
Yeah. Yeah. So, anyway,
I still have to go.
For James, and
omedetou. Are you gonna let me go, Kilara?
Brad?
Yes.
Yeah, Brad.
That's me.
Yeah. Sorry, I didn't hear you. What did you say?
Oh no, I have a whiskey too. If you want, if we can have people guess mine, but mine is from Ireland.
Yeah, but actually, I was wondering if we miss you, but Decanta said, nobody remembers your whiskey. Well, actually, you revealed your whiskey earlier, but...
Oh, no. This is not Glendronach 18, which you saw before, is my favorite everyday go-to drinking whiskey. And this is very much not that whiskey. This is a whiskey from Ireland, because I was told ahead of time that we already had Billy bringing in a beautiful Scotch, as he's already shown us all, and so we wanted to bring something from a different part of the world, this being Ireland. Glendronach just is a big hint, so you know where my flavor profile is at. Glendronach 18 is my favorite absolute everyday drinking whiskey, you know, when I'm not drinking something that's thousands and thousands of dollars. So that's where I'm normally at. Anyhow, so what we have here is an Irish. And there's not smoky notes, but there are some smoldering kind of notes. Definitely nothing peat or TCP-ish, none of those phenolics, but you get, what you're getting is kind of like a barbecue, more of a barbecue kind of note. And this is all just from the nose. But then of course, with that, there's a lot of prunes and sultanas and dark fruit, because I'm sure you could see from the color here that there is in fact some sherry influence. Of course, it is not Napogue. Let me just bring up the everybody just bringing tons of rapid fire guesses up here, so I gotta make sure I don't miss anything. All right. I'm gonna take a sip here. And it is very, there's oiling, it has a very oily mouthfeel, very slick, definitely coats your palate in a very nice way. And there's nuttiness, there's some beautiful, like, I wanna say, like, not marzipan, not like a sweet nut, but more like a very dry, like walnut type situation going on here. And the finish is really what this whiskey for me is all about and why I love, love, love it. Somebody like, you know, it's very divisive. Whiskey tasting, obviously so subjective, that's why we love it. But, you know, one of the world's most famous tasters and judges of whiskey, as he was, Jim Murray, would not like this whiskey at all. And that just goes to show, you know, to each their own. You should never put too much stock in one person's opinions unless you really know that person. You've already kind of dialed in and realized that you guys have, in fact, similar palates. This is, again, for people out there that are throwing all those Glens out there. This is an Irish. This is an Irish whiskey.
Okay. Irish whiskey. So, guys, audience.
Man, so good. And also just this complex finish. It's not just the length of the finish, which to me is really, really important because I like to be able to sit there and contemplate a whiskey. But it's how the finish evolves on your tongue. So you take your sip, it's tasting one way, and then all of a sudden, like, whoa, just something else completely different emerges. And we're talking about like 20 seconds after you've already sipped it and it's not even in your mouth. And you know, somebody has guessed the distillery so far. I will say that you can let me know, guys, when it's okay to reveal what the actual distillery is.
Red Breast.
It is not Red Breast. It is not Red Breast, nor is it made in Middleton.
You're sort of saying Jim Murray's not going to like it. I'm assuming there's a little bit of a struck match note in there somewhere, maybe?
There is a little bit of struck match. And I do like Jim. A little bit of sulfur in my whiskey.
Jim's favorite thing.
Okay, so can you guess?
Yeah, actually, you know, seeing this lineup of whiskey, so there are several different of this same liquid stream of various age statements. And I remember looking at the Whiskey Bible this year and seeing this one was literally like 20 points lower than another whiskey in the same line, same liquid, just of a different age statement, because that one didn't have those particular barrels, that particular cooperage integrated into the liquid stream that gives it, as you say, that struck match kind of note. It is not Tullamore. It is not Red Breast. It is not Connemara. Apologies to the Beam Suntory folks in the room, but this is not part of the Beam Suntory profile or portfolio.
You have ideas? You have ideas? You can say, but you guys.
Okay, so somebody just said the distillery. I'm going to all but give it away and say that this would be more of a whiskey for Protestants than it would be for Catholics, if we're gonna break it down by religious boundaries, which is a controversial topic, of course.
It's a Bushmills, right?
Yeah, I was gonna say, I feel like I might have already.
Okay.
I mean, the last time that I sipped this was a full on minute ago, and I am still tasting those residual notes. Is it older.
Bushmills 21?
Bushmills Black Bush.
It is somewhere in between those.
Difficult. Okay.
Is it a current release?
Yes, it is. It is widely available. Give us the distillery somewhere before we hit the 6-year party. I have given you Woolly Worm. I have revealed the distillery, unless you guys can name any other Northern Irish distillers. Okay, and we had Austin Soban is the person who got it first. This is Bushmills 16, which is a triple cast expression.
Austin? So he was the winner before too, right? So Austin?
Well, the one right after him was Rhea. Rhea. Matsuda.
Rhea.
Yeah.
Rhea and Austin? Wow.
Rhea got it right after.
Yeah, okay. So first of all, Austin, you are the winner, Bushmills 16. And you got the voucher.
Look at that beautiful color, huh?
Yeah, it suits the sea too. Wow, that's
love it.
I love the bottle. I've never tried it.
Oh my gosh, this is, I mean, as long as you're okay with a little bit of those sulfur notes. I think Jim Murray overblows it, or you know, blows it out of proportion with this one, but he is very, very sensitive to that, to those notes. I happen to think that this is a beautiful sherry bomb, particularly considering that it is not exclusively sherry cooperage. There's also streams of port and ex-bourbon in here. So it's Oloroso sherry, ex-bourbon, and port wine casks. and then they're combined together. So considering that theoretically only a third of the liquid in here is Oloroso sherry, this is a big time sherry bomb in a way that I just absolutely love. In the States, it's, you know, I don't know what it goes for in the UK, but it, probably even less. In the States, it's like about like $110, $120 tops. And to me, that's a really good value for how good this whiskey drinks. If you were getting a comparably complex Scotch single malt, it would be more expensive than that. And its complexity is belied by its age statement. This drink's a lot more complex than a 16-year-old you would expect.
Wow, thank you. And that was so beautiful whiskey. Wow.
Hashtag not sponsored.
You know, Brad, when I my first Irish whiskey, no joke, I ever drank, I was in a party and it was Bushmills. I mean, it wasn't Bushmills 16, but Bushmills, I think, is a phenomenal whiskey that gets overlooked by many.
Mm. Absolutely. I think so too. I think that, you know, if I can pick on them a little bit, I think they need to, in the States anyways, do a little bit better of a job positioning themselves, because, you know, the market share that Jameson has for us in the United States is obviously dominant. And these little guys come in and chip away at it. But most of the people that have made inroads in the States have been part of the Jameson portfolio anyways. They're all part of Irish distillers. So, you know, I feel like Proximo is missing an opportunity personally to, because this is a beautiful whiskey. Bushmills 21, that's my favorite Irish whiskey, flat out, bar none. That is exceptional. I will put that toe-to-toe with just about some of the finest 21-year-old Scotch malts. So, you know, it's a sleeper in the United States. I don't know how it is in the UK, but certainly in the United States.
Yeah.
If you get a chance to jump on some of the independent bottlings of anonymous Irish whiskey from the 1990s, which are all Bushmills, do so. Mm-hmm. Bushmills is fantastic, and from the 90s onwards has dominated that fruity Irish style. It's marvelous stuff.
There's a really interesting geeky fact that I learned on the Zoom call with some of our distillers the other day about sherry casks. I don't know if people are interested in geeky new knowledge. Is that something that people like? Sounds like it.
Yes, please tell us.
When I was taught about whiskey, I've only been in the whiskey world for 8 or 9 years now. But when I was taught about whiskey, the whole thing about like cask finishing was the idea that, you know, a lot of the flavors end up in your whiskey because some of that previous soaked in the barrel, and then when you put the whiskey in there, it all mixes together. So when you talk about sherry casks, it has those sherry flavors because, you know, that sherry liquid's mixed with the whiskey. And I was just talking to some of the distillery team at Yamazaki, and they were saying basically that they did some research. I'm not actually sure when, I think it was about 20, 30 years ago, but into Spanish oak and where the flavors come from, how it impacts the liquid. And what their research was basically suggesting that we've kind of been thinking about the story almost in reverse and a little bit flipped. Because I don't know if you guys drink much sherry yourselves, but I love sherry. My partner is Spanish. And so most of the sherry I drink is Manzanilla. I'm a big, like, absolute Manzanilla fan. And any Fino or Manzanilla-aged whiskies tend to go down a storm for me. But those young sherries don't have the flavors that we associate with a sherry cask, right? With a Spanish cask. They don't have those bright raisins, those sultanas, those dark winter. Mm-hmm. And so what that led the distilleries, distillery managers to think was like, maybe actually those flavors we associate with sherry actually come from the wood itself. And that's why older and more aged sherries have those flavors in greater abundance. When we think of like older PX and Oloroso sherries, that's where we taste raisin, sultana, and so on. So what they've suggested actually is it's not really so much about finding a cask that's been seasoned with sherry. That's not the key thing, although it's really important still. The key thing is it's that specific Spanish oak, because the different like molecular structure, I don't know, I'm not a scientist, but the difference of the oak is the thing that gives the flavors that we associate with sherry casks. So actually, Suntory no longer refer to them as sherry casks. You'll now see on all of their bottles, it says Spanish oak, because it's that specifically thing that they think from the research is what gives it that flavor. And I was fascinated because I've literally never thought about it like that.
Yeah, and also there's this misnomer, certainly among American drinkers that even care about cooperage to begin with, that if something is sherry cask, that it must be Spanish oak, whereas the overwhelming majority of stuff that are in those sherry Solera systems are all American oak barrels.
Yeah.
But also, it's not Soleras that are being broken down to mature anyway. It's just American oak barrels and Spanish oak barrels, European oak, which are being created. Well, they're being created, especially for the industry. But if you get a chance to, there are a few at tastings quite a lot of the time. Some of these guys will bring along an American oak sherry and a European oak sherry cask. And you try the same whiskey at the same age between the two of them. And exactly as James was saying, you know, the flavors are not just from the sherry itself. It's actually just, it's complemented by the wood as well.
Yeah. And it's, you can see why a lot of these distilleries have to work together. You see that relationship now between like the Macallan with Suntory, for example. They both value sherry so much, or Spanish cask so much, that these companies team up basically to make sure they've got access to it. Really interesting.
All right, Thomas, thank you very much. And honestly, we are running all the time, and I really appreciate your passionate against whiskey, and we really want to hear about you and hear you talking more. But yeah, so audience, just check their website or social medias for more information and more thoughts about whiskeys. And first of all, thank you very much, all panelists. And yeah, very first of all, congratulations on all winners. Omedetou gozaimasu. Wow, some guys got two vouchers. So all of the first guesses, you guys really know your whiskey. And if you are one of our first guesses, please email miriam@decanta.com, miriam@decanta.com, to redeem your voucher. And we will also put Miriam's email address in the chat sometime soon. So thanks again to our wonderful panelists, and that was really amazing and very wonderful talk. And domo arigatou gozaimashita. Thank you very much for joining, and now you can turn off your computer and the camera. Arigatou gozaimasu. You have a great night.
Thanks, Carla. Bye.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you. Nice being with you all. Thank you so much.
It's 1:30 in the morning here, so it's definitely bedtime. Good night.
Oh, wow. You are bedtime.
Okay.
Nice meeting you all, folks.
Yeah, maybe we can hear them talking about whiskey forever. Yeah, and we'd love to, but unfortunately, we are running over time. So let's move on to the next segment. That is Lip Sync Battle. Wee, wee. I love karaoke, and I know you love lip sync battle. So now it's time for battle. And there will be two rounds. And we would like you, the audience, to vote for your favorite and via the Zoom poll, which we will share at the end of each round. And if you haven't already told us you want to join in, then please let us know. But we are kind of running over time. So if you really want to join in, just type here in the chat right now, please.
All you need to do is move your lips. You don't have to actually sing, so don't worry.
Yeah. Yeah, we don't hear voice.
If you heard me and Kalara sing, everyone's windows and glasses would break.
Yeah. I can't sing anything with lip syncing. And I can sing like Michael Jackson with lip syncing. Yeah, so, and you can too. So please make sure your view with Zoom is of the gallery view, to ensure you are able to see all of the participants on the screen. Gallery view. So please make sure to set up the gallery view setting. So let's see who our participants are. So, okay, I need to change the view too, okay. Gallery view. Oh, this one, okay. This is... Now I have gallery view and so other participants on the screen. Now it's been setting up, I guess. Randy-san, arigatou gozaimasu. Thank you. Happy birthday, Decanta. Thank you and congratulations. I'll be willing to join the lip sync as long as I don't have to sing. Mm. You don't have to sing, but you have to sing in your mind. Okay, now we are adding everyone. It's taking a little bit while. Okay, so Austin, you want two vouchers, right?
Yeah, should I quit? Leave it for someone else? I'm at work.
Yes. Congratulations. Okay, and any other participants? Two new messages. So the winner gets Kigai bottle. Yeah. You can win Kigai bottle if you win. So yeah, just jump in. So Austin, where are you from?
I'm from California.
Ah, California.
Yeah, up in Amador County. I work at a winery.
Okay. Nice. Cool. And Jameson is in London, right?
I'm in London. Yeah, it's as we're saying, it's 1:40 in the morning, so I'm feeling that nightclub experience right now.
Definitely. And
good looking places.
It's crazy. Okay, so Noah and Ezzy. Oh yeah, Ezzy. Okay. Let's answer to her, Izzy.
Hello.
The team, please.
I'm not sure if I'm the team or not.
Oh, okay. Oh, I can. Okay, Uli Warm. Oh, you won the voucher too, right? Uli-san. Okay. Okay. Not everyone's
live from Texas.
Oh, Texas. Okay. Kanpare. Good luck. And Stratis, thank you for joining. You also won a voucher, right? All the winners here. You didn't? Oh, okay. Sorry. But now you have the chance to win battle, Kigai battle for lip syncing. Yeah, good luck. And yeah, Enzi, hello. So tonight we have Ezzy on the screen. Some of you might remember from an earlier Decanter lockdown episode, and she is a rising star and a singer-songwriter and actress from Los Angeles. And thank you very much for joining. So you'll be lip syncing too? Yeah. Have you ever tried lip syncing?
Have I ever tried lip singing?
Yeah.
No, not really. I'm super bad at remembering the words to songs that I'm super bad at that. So unless I prepare, but I'll do my best.
Good luck. All right, so now we have everyone. Okay. So all right. So we gotta play music and you just do express what you got. Okay? It's gonna be like 30 seconds to 1 minute. Yeah, just show me what you got. All right, so are you ready?
Mama.
Mama.
So, at the same time, or are we taking turns?
Sorry?
Are we doing this at the same time or are we taking turns?
Everyone at the same time.
Okay, got it.
Okay. Wow. The real singer-songwriter, but I don't know how she can do well on lip syncing. She's an amazing singer-songwriter, but without singing, how can she do? All right, so let's see. And now everyone is ready. So, all right. 3, 2, 1, hit it.
What's the
Humanity, you know. That was very, very beautiful. Okay, so oh no, it's not official winner announcement. All right, so this is Decanta's Got Talent, and the first round winners. We have two winners from the first round, and okay, now we have two winners of the first round. Okay, first of all, everyone was really great, amazing. But yeah, I'm sorry. We need to choose just the two from all of you guys. Okay, so as I said, we are kind of running over time, so maybe, okay, we gotta crown the two winners from this round, and we gotta give those two winners, both of the winners, a bottle of Japanese whiskey. So, the winners are... Them, Ezzy and Shannon.
Thank you.
Wow. Well, personally, I really like yeah, guys. Also, a really good, great job, Austin and Stratis. You guys are also amazing, and Noah, and thank you very much for joining. But anyway, Ezzy and Shannon won the Kigai whiskey bottle, and thank you very much for joining all participants. You are amazing. Arigato!
Thank you.
Congrats,
Shannon.
Okay,
thank you.
I wore my special Carson Kresley outfit so I could judge you all properly in true
Yeah, you can put this title on your CV, right?
Yeah.
Lip sync battle winner. All right. So from now on, we're gonna make a huge announcement. So now for the moment, you've all been waiting for and our decant anniversary bottling is always a big event. And this year we have something very, very special to show you. Jameson, thank you so much. So, but before that, let me tell you a little story. Sasanokawa Shuzo was founded back in 1765. And for 150 years, they perfected the craft of sake and shochu production. And in 1945, they were granted a license to distill whiskey and launched the Yamazakura brand. And at around about the same time, they made Japanese whiskey history by helping Ichiro Akuto to launch his new famous Ichiro's Moto brand. In 2015, Sasanokawa Shuzo built the Asaka Distillery in the mountains of Fukushima Prefecture, and their whiskey distilling journey began. We are very proud to reveal today our fifth anniversary bottling, the second ever single malt to come from the Asaka Distillery. Let me introduce the Decanter exclusive Asaka Aoi Edition. Amazing and beautiful bottle. So we've been working closely with the distillery in recent months, and we were absolutely thrilled to be given the chance to bottle this special cask as an exclusive for our fifth anniversary. Aoi is the Japanese word for blue, a color which has huge significance in Japanese culture and in cultures across the globe. It means purity, cleanliness, ocean, and peace. Distilled in 2017, this whiskey was matured in the first fill bourbon cask for 3 years before bottling in 2020. Only 343 bottles were produced, so act fast if you want to get your hands on one. Visit our website to find out more about the Decanter exclusive Asaka Aoi edition. Yeah, so... I'm so happy to review this beautiful bottle. And this is the fifth anniversary exclusive bottle. So if you wanna have this beautiful and amazing and yeah, very meaningful bottle, for us and the globe, please go to the website and just check this bottle, please. Wow. As I said, we are running over time, but it's very, very wonderful time. And that was really great Saturday morning for me and the Friday night for you guys, I hope. So now, let me announce the winner of hashtag Toast Decanter photo competition. So at the start of our party, we shared with you the top entries to our Toast Decanter social media competition. We always have so many wonderful entries for this contest, and it's always so hard to pick winner. So this time we let the audience decide. The votes on Facebook have been tallied, and we have a couple of winners. So the runner-up for the 2020 Toast Decanter Anniversary Contest is okay. Let me announce the winner again. From the beginning. So the runner-up for the 2020 Toast Decanter Anniversary Contest is we have two. So we have first place and the second place. So let me introduce the second place of the Toast Decanter Anniversary Contest is Kelsey from Cape Town. Kelsey, omedetou! Okay, so runner up for this year contest was Kelsey from Cape Town. She was a beautiful lady from South Africa. Thank you very, very much for joining. Domo arigatou gozaimasu. And the winner of 2020 Toast Decanter Anniversary Contest, who will receive a bottle of Hibiki. Sorry, I'm kind of messed up. So for Kelsey, a runner-up of 2020 competition, you got Yamazaki 12 year old. Kelsey with Yamazaki 12 years old. Omedetou gozaimasu! Just drink it. Yeah. You posted a picture of drinking Suntory old, but stay young and drink whiskey forever. Enjoy our life. Okay, and let me announce the winner of 2020 Toast Decanter Anniversary Contest, who will receive a bottle of Hibiki 17 year old is Frank with his hot dog. Omedetou gozaimasu. Frank with Hibiki 17 year old. Omedetou gozaimasu. Wow. We're just gonna drink Hibiki. His favorite hot dog or Frank? Enjoy together. Anyway, thank you very much, all participants, and every picture is really great and so amazing. And we are so, so happy about receiving those pictures of you guys. And domo arigatou gozaimashita. Thank you very much for joining. And congratulations, all winner of 2020 photo contest. Arigatou gozaimashita. So, Kelsey and Frank, we will be in touch with you both on social media, and thank you again for your beautiful pictures. So, as I said, we're running out of time, but I hope you enjoyed this whole show, and I was really happy seeing you in live today. So, but I'm sorry to say that this is the end of our first ever Decanter Live, and it's been wonderful to be able to party with you, even though we are all across the globe. And the Decanto family are very, very special to us. And we are very proud to have such a supportive and enthusiastic group of people on the journey with us. We look forward to seeing you again for our 6th anniversary next June. And in the meantime, we will be keeping touch through Decanta TV. We had a plan to end the Japanese whiskey lockdown earlier this month, but the response has been so amazing. We brought it back for one more episode. After that, we will be returning with a whole new show for Decanta TV in 2 weeks' time, so keep an eye on it. So the final episode of the Decanta TV Japanese Whiskey Lockdown will be airing on the Decanta YouTube channel at 8:30 p.m. EDT tonight. Well, actually, it's over, but well, we're going to be airing. So please keep your eyes on it. And okay, it'll be aired in 30 minutes. Yeah, so just stick with our YouTube channel and enjoy our final episode of Japanese Whiskey Lockdown. So I really look forward to seeing you then to continue party. And so stay safe and keep drinking Japanese whiskey and enjoy our lives. Guys, thank you very much for joining and tuning into this live streaming. And have a great day and have a great night and have a great life. See you! Arigatou!